And we are back. Thanks, everyone, for joining us again. As our conference is of hybrid nature, part online and part live, so we'll beam our next two keynote speeches. We will first hear from Mr. Jure Leskovec. He's an associate professor of computer science at Stanford University, also a chief scientist at Pinterest, and investigator at Chan Zuckerberg BioHub. Now, his research focuses on machine learning and data mining, large social information and biological networks. Computation over massive data is at the heart of his research and has applications in computer science, in social sciences, marketing, and biomedicine as well. Professor Leskovec will speak about the growing competition for AI talents, a view from the two sides of the Atlantic.
Hi, my name is Jure Leskovec. I'm associate professor of computer science at Stanford University, working in the field of AI. But perhaps more importantly, I'm originally from Slovenia and received most of my education and training actually here in Slovenia. Today, I'm going to talk about the growing global competition for the AI talent. And I'll give a view from both sides of the Atlantic. If we look at the investment in AI in terms of education and interest, it has actually tripled in the last 10 years. So the graph I'm showing here shows the number of new CS undergraduate students at doctoral institutions, meaning universities in North America from 2010 to 2019. And what you can see is that the number of computer science graduates has tripled in the last 10 years. It went from around 10,000 to around 30,000. Second thing that I want to show is a graph from my institution, from Stanford University, where I'm showing you the graph of the growth of artificial intelligence classes in the past decade at Stanford University. And what you can see is that in 2010, we had about 25 different courses at Stanford universities that were related to the field of AI. Today, that number has over tripled to 77 different courses that Stanford students can take in order to gain training and educations in the field of artificial intelligence. So it means that in 10 years, we have over tripled the amount of classes, the curriculum in AI at Stanford University alone. Another important aspect of AI education in the United States is that it's getting increasingly international. In this graph, I'm showing you the fraction of international students enrolled in AI-related PhD programs in the United States. And what you have see is that the number of international students or the fraction of international students increased drastically in the last 10 years. And today, 64% of all PhD students in the United States are international students. So United States is pulling the talent from all over the globe to go to United States and study in the field of AI. Perhaps what is interesting and important and why this is being done is that over 80% of these new PhD students, new graduates, actually stay in United States to get jobs there. So 82% of international PhDs stay educated in United States, stay there, which is a huge plus both for the United States research institutions as well as for the industry, as we are going to see next. When we ask ourselves, where are these new PhDs? Where do they get jobs? Another big shift that has happened in the last 10 years is that in the past, about half got jobs in academia at universities to become professors, and the other half went to industry. In the last 10 years, the share of industry hiring of the new PhDs in AI has drastically increased. And now over 65% of all new PhDs get jobs in industry. And the share of academia has dropped over time, and now it's only at the 23% level. So the interest of industry to hire these brightest PhD graduates in the field of AI has drastically increased in the last 10 years. And you have to account also for the fact that the number of PhD graduates has also increased by a factor of 3. So the need for this talent in industry is really huge and immense. So now that I surveyed the situation in the United States, I want to focus my attention to the situation in European Union in this regard. And what we see is that in terms of research impact in the field of AI, European Union or countries of European Union are significantly lagging. So in this graph, I'm showing you the fraction of AI journal citations, fraction of the world total by geographic area. This is going from the year 2000 to the year 2020. And what you've seen in what you see is that back in the year 2000, the fraction of all world citations in the field of AI was dominated by the United States at around 40%. Europe was at around, let's say, 15-17%, and China was close to zero. What happened in the last 20 years is an immense increase and a growth of the share of citations to works produced by Chinese authors in Chinese institutions. And it has just happened that actually US and China have crossed, and now about 20% of the world citations go to AI papers that were published by Chinese institutions. Another 20% goes to United States, but the share of European Union has actually dropped, and now it's only around 11%. So in terms of the research output and the impact of that research, European Union is lagging and is only having an impact of about half of what US or China are having in this artificial intelligence area. At the same time, what we are also seeing is that there is large inequality or inequity between different European countries in terms of a number of specialized AI programs that are available in these countries. And we see that big European countries, in Germany and France, are kind of dominating. We see Netherlands also offering many different specialized AI programs, followed by the Scandinavian countries, and then having a sharp drop-off. And what we also see is that there is a lot of smaller European countries that do not have many specialized AI programs. And what does this mean is that the students from these countries cannot get specialized education in artificial intelligence, and it means they have to leave their home countries, for example, like myself. So the question then becomes, what would be some possible solutions, or what could European Union do to get to move forward and to solve some of these problems? And the first thing I would like to propose, or I would say is very important, is to establish new platforms of collaboration and flow of knowledge between top European institutions, research institutions all over the Europe. Because we need to create a diverse ecosystem of experts, right? As I showed, Europe is not keeping up. Many of the top labs and universities are actually in North America, in the United States. And in terms of AI investment in AI, China and North America are significantly larger and significantly outspending. And this means also their impact is far bigger than what Europe is doing. So, for example, a European Laboratory of Learning and Intelligent Systems, ELIS, is a distributed laboratory unifying many different European institutions and trying to create a new platform, an ecosystem of experts where the knowledge can flow more freely, and this way education also and training get more accessible and the impact of research gets amplified. Another example of this type of effort is something I would like to mention coming here in Slovenia. Slovenian professors all over the world have established what we call ASEF, American Slovenian Education Foundation, which is a network of Slovenian professors at world's top universities. And here I'm showing you some of the universities which from which these professors come, mostly from United States, United Kingdom, Australia, New Zealand, and also some European countries. And we offer fellowship programs for Slovenian students to go visit and do perform research with these professors at the world's top universities to gain training and knowledge that is simply not accessible and not available in Slovenia. And then we ask these students, would you return back to Slovenia or would you like to stay abroad? And if I said before that 80% of PhD students that graduate in United States stay in United States through this ASEF platform, we see that 71% of the students actually want to come back or are thinking of coming back and returning back to Slovenia. So what this means is that the brain drain can be reversed, and we can talk about brain circulation, where students are able to go get new knowledge, new training, and then come back to their home countries, find employment, and create new value there. So to summarize, what is important for the Europe is to really create an ecosystem, to have strong research universities that are practically oriented and entrepreneurial. For example, it is not a coincidence that Stanford alumni founded companies like Google, VMware, Cisco, Nvidia, Netflix, Nike, and many others. It is important to create this ecosystem where we have highly educated workforce in many different areas, in engineering, in marketing, in legal, sales, and everything, everywhere else. It is important to have centers of excellence, to truly have superstars and invest in those superstars, be it institutions, be it geographical areas, to have critical mass of talent all in one place. And then another important aspect is the aspect of workforce mobility, where people are able to move between companies freely and without the non-compete agreements. For example, in California, there are no non-competitive agreements that employees have to sign, which means that the flow of people and the flow of knowledge and ideas is far accelerated, which lifts all the companies and the entire ecosystem. And the last two points I want to mention is availability of what I will call venture capital. And here I'm not only talking about funding, but I'm really talking about investing to help most innovative, transformative ideas to get from a concept to a flourishing enterprise. And this means it is much, much more than just providing funding. It's about providing connections, providing mentoring, helping people to hire, and this way grow these enterprises. And in Silicon Valley, we call this blitz scaling. It's an art of rapidly building out a company to serve a large and usually global market, which means that once we see that idea has been validated, it is very important to rapidly scale and grow that idea to maintain the leadership position. And if we are able in European Union to create an ecosystem with all these four components, I think there is a bright future for us looking ahead. Thank you so much, and it was a pleasure to give a talk.
Hope you enjoyed the speech by Professor Jure Leskovec.